and welcome back to another video with It's Dr. Dan, and today we're going to be learning how to read a chemical formula. More specifically, we're going to learn how to count the number of atoms you have within the different compounds you find in these formulas. So, what is this all about? What do we know so far? Well, the first thing is that we know is that atoms make up all matter. And that atoms are made up of different subatomic particles, which is leading to them bonding together because they want and desire all these different numbers of electrons in order to try to achieve the octet rule. However, most matter that we see do not really exist just as atoms. As we're starting to realize, most of matter that you see around you is in the form of compounds. Whether it's maybe like the different materials that make up your phone or the screen on it, your laptop keys, the walls of your home, maybe the desk that you're sitting at, your bed, all these things are made of compounds. This is the majority of things that exist in our world. So what we're going to try to do is learn how we can count them here and try to understand the basic concepts in this fundamental video. Let's take a look. The first thing about chemical formulas is that they can have the following things. So the first one is that they will have the element symbols that you can find on your periodic table. Now, this is one of the reasons it's very important that you are memorizing your periodic table. It makes it easier to do your general chemistry course. Even some classes don't even give you the complete information. It fully depends on who your teacher is, what they're giving you. Need to know those symbols. As a general rule of thumb for me and my students, I recommend the first 20 know the symbols, know your names, because they are some of the most common that we have in our world. After that, we're going to be using subscripts. So what exactly is a subscript? So if I have, let's say, water right here, H2O, a subscript is a number that's written on as like a lower font. So this is what we refer to as a subscript. So what subscripts are for are telling you the number of atoms that are in this molecule. So for this one, this is letting you know that you have two hydrogen atoms that are here. Okay, so we have two hydrogens. So that is a very important piece of information for when we say we have water. Here. Sometimes you'll also see the use of parentheses as well. Now we'll talk about them more in detail soon, but they're usually used to group certain polyatomics or formula units together. So that way you are counting and balancing your charges correctly. Okay. So it's very important that when something's in parentheses, they stay together. They belong together. Okay. Just letting you know how many units of that particular molecule you have. Okay. So for this particular one, you can see that you have two hydrogens and then we have a single oxygen in H2O. So what about the subscript that is over here for oxygen? Notice that's currently vacant. So what that means is that there is a one here. So it is telling you there's only one element. Generally, we leave it blank, but depending on how you are being graded on different assessments, you might have to put the number one there, especially if it's something that's more of an auto-graded response. But that means there's one single oxygen. So let's write that down. All right, let's go on to our next part so that way we can learn a little bit more of these different chemical formulas. All right, so I have magnesium hydroxide here written for us, and we are going to go through what the general rule is for parentheses. So how exactly do they work? Well, what the first thing we are looking for is our subscripts. One thing you can notice right away, there is no subscript written next to magnesium. So what can we exactly say about that? Is that Mg, there is one atom of Mg here, right? So one atom of magnesium. Now, what about the parentheses here? How does this work? Well, the general idea here is that this 2 is going to be distributed to each of the individual elements within, meaning it's multiplying each one of those elements. So being that each one of these has a little box next to them, remember, they're just one. So in a sense, the way that this works is if I have oxygen here, you are essentially taking one times two in this case, which is telling you, hey, you have two oxygen atoms. And that's the same thing for hydrogen, right? We do two times one, and we can see that we have two hydrogen atoms within magnesium hydroxide. So when we're trying to understand this general rule here, when you're counting the number of atoms, first you got to count how many there are within the parentheses. So as you saw with oxygen, hydrogen above, I counted one within each of them. Now, most of the time when you have parentheses, you generally have a number outside, meaning an additional subscript. So this is going to be used to multiply what's within. So what do I mean by that? Let's just do a very, very hypothetical example like the one that is here. So what are we going to do? Let's count these numbers and letters for A, B, and C, these fake elements. How would it work? So the first thing I want to do is let's just count the number of A elements. And what you can see is that, oh, we got a W here. It's not in parentheses. So what that tells you is that A is equal to W amount of atoms, right? So W atoms. What about B? Okay, so B has the subscript of X next to it, but notice that it's inside of these parentheses. So how does that exactly work? Z is going to distribute itself to both of these species. Now, when we are writing formulas, you do not carry this out like a normal math problem. We're just using this to count the number of atoms so you know how many there are. We leave it in its formula, okay? So it's there, it's in that format for a reason, because it's letting you know the different units that exist. But when we're counting atoms, all we're doing is taking X times Z, and that's telling you however many atoms you have, okay? So that's the number. Now, when it comes to C, same idea, right? We're going to take Y times Z, and you'll have that many atoms. Let's take a look at a real one so that maybe it'll help it make a little bit more sense. Let's take a look. Okay, so in this example, we are going to be counting how many of each atom exist within a formula. So this is very similar to the alphabetical one we had earlier. So what are we going to be doing first? Well, we got to realize we have a bunch of different subscripts here. So let's first start with iron. We can see iron's outside of the subscript. There's nothing written there. So we can automatically assume we have one atom of iron. Now, what else do we have? Well, let's take a look. So if we look at nitrogen next, we see that there's nothing written there. So once again, it's a one. So how is that going to work? Well, we have a two outside of it. So what we will do here is we'll simply take that two, times that by one, and we have a total of two atoms of nitrogen within this compound. Now with oxygen, we have a three inside. We're going to multiply that as well. So three times two, and that lets you know, hey, you have six atoms of oxygen. Now, just to kind of illustrate, what does this represent? Remember, ionic compounds exist in a lattice type of network. So what this is kind of letting you know is that, hey, we have this iron 2 plus that's here, and there are different nitrate units on each side. So it's kind of like we have, let's say, an NO3 on one side, NO3 on the other, and they're surrounding this iron, and it's in a repeating framework. Okay, so there's many of these in a row. And notice how I'm keeping the NO3s together. That's the important part. The parentheses keep them together. You do not carry it out like a math operation. Generally, the way you will see these is how it was originally presented. Let's take a look at our next one. So our next one here is essentially we have calcium arsenate. So calcium arsenate is the same idea. So we're going to be counting all these different species that we have. So we notice all, there's some subscripts here. So the first one was for calcium. We have three atoms of calcium. Now we have, once again, our parentheses. We have a two outside of that. So we're going to be distributing it to all the different species within. So the first one is arsenate, which only has a one next to it. And we're going to multiply that by two. Oxygen has a four next to it. And we're also going to multiply that by two. And so we have two arsenate atoms and then eight oxygen atoms in this compound. Okay. So this is the whole idea of when we're looking at compounds and molecules. This is how we can count them for chemical formulas and be able to read them correctly. Thank you so much for watching. I hope that this video helped you understand chemical formulas a little bit better for the future. And please, if you have not already, hit that like and subscribe button. Please help support this channel so we can spread more chemistry to more students. And I hope to see you all in the future. Bye now.